Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this morning's worship. We draw near to God, our Creator, who makes us and shapes us, the provider of all our needs and the guider of our paths. We listen to God's word so we can live our best lives for the Lord, bringing peace to this world. Let us have the mind of Christ as we draw nearer into his presence. Let us pray. God of blessing and joy, thank you for your gifts, which are more than we can ever ask or imagine. Thank you for the gift of life, which is precious and sacred. Thank you for the gift of faith, which is a light in the darkness. Thank you for the gift of hope, which is an anchor for the soul. Thank you for the gift of love, which is the greatest of all. Thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and our friend. Amen.
Heavenly Father and Creator of heaven and earth, we thank you that your mercies are new every morning, reminding us of the everlasting love that you have for us all. We thank you for gifting us this new day, and ask that you will be with us in the week ahead. Lord, we do not know what challenges the new week might bring. There may be none, but if there are any, we know that you will go before us and equip us to deal with the situation, whatever it might be. In our prayers of intercession, we remember the sick and infirm, and those suffering from mental health issues. We remember the bereaved, and those who feel lost and alone, and are without hope. We remember those who are homeless and on the streets, and those who are in despair. We ask that you watch over them and protect them from harm, and lead them to a safer and better place, spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and physically. We pray for those in church today who need your care and healing, and we remember those who are unable to attend due to sickness. We pray that you will take care of their needs, bless and strengthen them, Lord. We pray for Pastor Kathy, that you will bless her and be with her as she ministers unto us. We pray that our church will grow in fellowship and love. Help us to always keep focused on you, whatever our circumstances might be. Father, we pray for those countries where war and conflict continue at a pace and peace seems so remote. We pray for the innocent victims caught up in the senseless violence who have lost their homes and loved ones, livelihoods and freedom. We pray for peace and that it comes quickly. Loving Father, instill in those who lead humility of heart and a sense of justice and righteousness with a genuine desire for peace. Lord, we take comfort in knowing that you are our help and strength in times of trouble. Thank you for keeping us strong, even in the toughest times of life. There are times when everything feels so overwhelming that we question whether we'll be able to climb the mountain. In the struggles, you remain our hope and strength and our purpose. You reassure us and let us know that you will win the battle for us. Lord, you never give up on us or lose sight of us. Though in our pain, sorrow and distress, we sometimes lose sight of you and your purpose for our lives. Lord, you said, "Don't worry because I am with you. Don't be afraid because I am your God. I will make you strong and will help you. I will support you with my right hand that saved you. I am the Lord your God who holds your right hand, and I tell you, don't be afraid. I will help you. As we start this new week, dear Father God, we ask for your direction, strength, and blessing. If we are feeling troubled, confused, tired, and weary, remind us of your presence and unfailing love, and help us to trust in you. Father, we pray that the rest of this day and week will be filled with your grace, and that your light will continue to shine upon us, filling our hearts with gladness and joy. We ask that you hear our prayers in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
The first reading is from Mark chapter 9, verses 30 to 37. Jesus left that place and passed through Galilee. Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were, because he was teaching his disciples. He said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." But they did not understand what he meant, and were afraid to ask him about it. Then they came to Capernaum. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet, because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest. Sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, "Anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the servant of all." He took a little child whom he placed among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me, but the one who sent me." And then from James chapter 3, verses 13 to chapter 4, verse 3, and then chapter 7 to 8a. "Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbour bitterness, envy, and self-ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you will find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive, because you ask with wrong motives, and that you may spend what you get on your pleasures." And then from verse 7, "Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded."
Over the last few weeks, a recurring theme has been appearing in what James has had to say to the Christians he was writing to. Wisdom. Get wisdom. Value wisdom. Make use of wisdom. Wisdom. It helps you figure out what is happening to you and around you, and to work out your next step in moving on in life. It makes you more focused in everything you put your hand to. It spurs you on when you feel down in spirits and things seem to be crumbling around you. When there is confusion in the air, wisdom helps you to make sense of life and provides you with the necessary understanding of people around you. James makes a clear distinction between wisdom that is imparted by God, which James calls heavenly wisdom, and the forms of wisdom that are derived from life on this earth, which he calls earthly and spiritual and even demonic forms of wisdom. As we make our way through life, we tend to think that wisdom is wisdom, wherever it comes from. After all, don't you use wisdom in the same way to the same end, whether it is God-given or life learned upon this earth? To make better choices. James explains the different ways in which wisdom is put to good use. Heavenly wisdom is pure. There is no hidden agenda in our hearts and minds. Once received, it is put to use for the greater good without any thought of benefiting self. Its aims are to encourage peace, to be considerate, to submit oneself to the service of God and others, to show mercy and bear good fruit, to be impartial and sincere. Unspiritual wisdom is based on envy, selfish ambition, covetousness, quarrelsomeness, which might lead to conflict, and addiction to pleasure at the expense of the good of others. We can be wise and cunning in our actions and motives. We act wisely in order to benefit ourselves and achieve our own ends. We may use unspiritual wisdom to get what we want when we want, and in the process walk over other people who get in our way. We will use the wisdom of others, sometimes handed down the generations through time, in order to get that job, obtain that prime property, secure that place in the educational establishment for our children, or complete the financial transactions which will bring in the returns to set us on our feet and make us financially secure. It is good to be ambitious, but not to allow one's ambition to run away with selfish pursuit at any cost. It is good to take wise decisions and make sensible choices, but not at the expense of others around you. Although heavenly wisdom is God-given wisdom, it is often learned and taken on board as the Spirit leads us throughout our lives, from infancy through to maturity of age. The Holy Spirit can guide and direct those who have not yet come to a knowledge of Jesus in their lives. A young child who's drawn to the Lord and desires to be the Lord's person in all they are and all they do can absorb that heavenly wisdom in their heart and mind and store it all up for its later outworking in their life of following Christ. In Robert Fulghum's book, All I Really Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten, the author suggests that there are some things learned by the age of five that are still relevant and important for your life now. He summarises his own wisdom as this: share everything, play fair, don't hit people, put things back where you found them, clean up your own mess, say you're sorry when you hurt someone, wash your hands before you eat, flush, warm cookies and cold milk are good for you, live a balanced life, draw and paint and sing and dance, and play and work every day. Take a nap in the afternoon. When you go out into the world, watch out for the traffic. Hold hands and stick together. Be aware of wonder. Learning these wise habits from an early age can give us a head start when it comes to getting to know the Lord. The young adult who has taken on board all of these behavioural traits will understand what God is about when it comes to developing a personal relationship with the Lord. God's wisdom, spiritually imbibed, will make sense when that person comes to faith. Hopefully, they will not succumb to the sin of pride and will humbly accept every single crumb of heavenly wisdom the Lord gives to them each and every day. They will thrive because their heart and spirit will be in the right place. James wants his hearers and readers to stop what they feel they want to do and ask the Lord for wisdom in taking the next step. They need to ask themselves, as does each of us who love the Lord, whether hearts and motives and actions are in the right place. To search themselves, asking whether they're being guided in their actions by wisdom from God, or whether they're being driven by their own desires and impulses. Jesus teaches us that you will know them by their fruit. We will be able to discern whether people are being led by the Lord. We simply need to take a look at the sort of fruit that they are producing in their lives. As always, people can either produce good fruit or bad fruit in their lives. When we forget about the small things in living in society and in our communities, like littering in the street or not caring about the way we drive or begrudging people a share of food, a living wage, a roof over their heads and healthcare, then we are in danger of producing bad fruit and showing this in our selfishness, our pride and our me first attitudes. James wants to draw us near to the Lord at all times and for us to seek the guidance of the Holy Spirit daily in all that we do, to seek the wisdom of the Lord in order to help us grow and to mature in the faith. Then we will be able to produce good spiritual fruit in our lives and act with the wisdom of God in all things. We will choose to trust God in our lives and care about the sorts of things in the world that he cares about too. James asks us to submit ourselves to God and to resist the devil, to come near to God, and God then will come near to us. Then we will be able to make good choices in our lives, informed by God's wisdom and not by whim or based on a selfish desire. We are told in the Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 7, that wisdom passes into holy souls and makes them friends of God. May we know the wisdom of God in our souls all throughout our lives. May we produce good fruit so that the beauty of Jesus be seen in us and in all that we put a hand to this coming week. Let us pray. God, may we be great in your eyes by being humble. Help us to be wise by following your word. May we be blessed by being your blessing and by choosing you. Amen. The grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God,
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore. Amen.